leader, and I'm thankful for all of you here. Every year I come, it is such an honor to celebrate surfing, our people, our roots at this wonderful, amazing place, the Honolulu Museum of Art. Thank you, Taylor Chang, for hosting and directing and having us all gather together. So I would like to give a toast to your friend, a courageous heart, an amazing big wave surfer, a father, a good husband, and a good human being. And I'm so glad that Peter Kohl walks the planet.
Yeah. Here's to Buzzy, Kid Horn, and Rick.
Yeah. Yeah. Cheer. 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 Cheer.
People to thank. First off, we at the museum send our huge mahalos to our presenting sponsor, Nordstrom. They've supported, yes, Mirage and Nordstrom. They've supported this festival for the past many years, and without their support, we wouldn't be able to have this festival for an entire month. So thank you so much. We also need to thank Surf Jack Hotel and Swim Club, as well as Ed Kenny. Yes. For partnering with us this year, and for the incredible food provided by Mahina and Sons and Ed Kenny's team. Thank you so much. I gotta thank Kona Brewing Company for providing the beer, best beer on the island. Mahalo. Men in Gray Suits for the awesome music and entertainment. And definitely the Surf News Network, Gary Keeley. Where are you in the audience? Yes, back there. Thank you so much. This festival and Oceanic Cable, thank you. And also, all of you just got a free magazine by Trim Magazine. And thank you to Matt Luttrell, who is the editor of this magazine, for donating all of the beautiful photographs. Please do check it out and please subscribe to his magazine.
Theater. So, without further ado, let's announce the winner of the surfboard. Drum roll. All right. We hope you're here. I know. Is Maria Preston in the audience?
Anna Trent Moore to the stage. She has supported this festival almost from the very beginning. She is the director of the Bud Browne Archives, and it's through her work that Bud Browne's films are preserved and shared. As you will find out, she is a fantastic, inspiring storyteller. And Bud Browne's films are so lucky to have her as its keeper. She was born and raised in Makaha. She's a surfer, an author, a historian, and daughter of the big wave surfing legend, Buzzy Trent. So please join me in a warm welcome to Anna Trent Moore.
Mahalo, Nui Lowell, for that wonderful introduction and the words that honor our sport and the people that are gathering here tonight for it. I would like to thank Taylor once again, and also her amazing staff and the Honolulu Museum of Art for yet another fantastic film festival. I'd like to thank my friend Kyle Metcalf. We've been coming here for 7 years. And for 6 of those years, he has faithfully come to film and document our special evening so that we can revisit and treasure for all time. I would also like to thank all of you for being here at this most special moment in time in this evening to celebrate and honor not only one of my family's dearest friends, but also one of the greatest patriarchs of surfing, Mr. Peter Kohl. I would also like to thank our special guest who will be speaking later. And tonight, our warmest welcome and mahalo to the man of the evening, Mr. Peter Kohl. This evening's program will begin with our tribute, followed by our special speakers, then our Bud Browne film of the evening, Surfing the 50s. Timing and circumstance opened a path for Peter Kohl, which led him to his destiny as a big wave surfer. The year was 1938 in Santa Monica, California. To accommodate the city's large student population, Los Angeles had a year-round school system referred to as the A and B program. As timing would have it, 8-year-old Peter and his brother Corny Kohl, Buzzy Trent, and Kit Horn were placed on the B schedule. A circumstance which would not only set them up to travel their school life together, but created a happenstance that inevitably forged them into becoming lifelong friends for the rest of their lives. Living in the same neighborhood, it was the Kohl and Trent home that became the hangout place for the neighborhood kids. Living their happy young boy lives, riding bikes, playing ball, it was a golden time in California. An idyllic childhood, not far from the Pacific Ocean, where before learning to surf, they body surfed, fished off the paddleboards, having a great time. Living near the ocean, they began surfing at a young age, and as they grew older, became part of the early Santa Monica watermen, surfing, swimming, and lifeguarding. At the time, the Lifeguard Association were split into two, the City of Santa Monica Lifeguards and the Los Angeles City Lifeguards. With a competitive spirit and a deep rivalry between the two, Peter and Buzzy were lifeguards for the City of Santa Monica. Each year, the Los Angeles City had a fierce relay competition with the LA County. It was brutal, with LA County whipping the city lifeguards every single year. Each year, another inscribed plaque would be hung on the wall reading, County, County, County. But in 1953, for the Santa Monica crew, it would be different. Buzzy Trent, Peter Kohl, and Kit Horn entered the relay as part of a 6-man team. The relay consisted of a swim, paddleboard, and dory race. Kit and Peter teamed up in the swimming, Buzzy and Peter teamed up in the paddle, and all 6 were in the dory race. Well, they won the event, beating LA County for the first time in history. The celebrations lasted 2 weeks straight when, according to Peter, no one was sober the whole time. Many of the Santa Monica crew went on to college at USC, but Peter chose to attend Stanford University. Upon graduating from Stanford, he took a job teaching at Pacific Coast High School, when in 1958, timing presented a choice that would change the trajectory of Peter Cole's life, creating a circumstance that opened a door to destiny. John Fox, a high school principal from Hawaii, arrived in California to interview applicants to teach at Hawaii's Punahou High School. The lure of surfing Hawaiian big waves inspired Peter to interview for a possible position. Fox offered Peter a job right on the spot, but rather than accepting it immediately, the pragmatic nature of Peter said that he'd have to think about it. To which Fox replied, "But I need to know your answer now." He thought about the lure of the big surf in Hawaii, and so after a very short think about it, he said, "Okay." And it was in Hawaii that surfing became the complete backdrop of his life. Not just surfing, but surfing the biggest waves he could find. Often with friends like George Downing, Fred Van Dyke, Ricky Gregg, Buzzy Trent, and Kimo Hollinger. Fearlessness in tackling big surf is now stuff of legend. Pioneering the North Shore in this time of pre-jet ski, no lifeguards at bay, and no leashes. He had developed a reputation as a calm and steadfast big wave surfer that exemplified grace under pressure. Calmly determined in the most brutal of conditions, Fred Van Dyke was quoted as saying that whenever checking out the monster surf with Peter Cole, the words he dreaded most that inevitably came from Peter's mouth was, "I think that can be ridden." Because then they'd all be forced to man up and paddle out. But while we are here to honor Peter Cole as a surfer who has cut a path, which inspires others to follow, the truth is, he is so much more than that. Husband, friend, father, and steward of the place that he has called home for over 60 years, he has fought and continues to fight to keep the country country. Living. Living the example of Malama for the coastline with devoted stewardship, passion, and conviction. So tonight, it is our honor to sing your praises, Mr. Peter Cole. For many, we are proud to call you friend. For all, we are grateful for the path that you continue to carve. Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome you all to tonight's tribute to Mr. Peter Cole. A longtime friend and lifeguard compadre to Peter Cole, it gives me great pleasure to welcome Mr. Don Rohrer, and a legendary big wave charger in the arena of big water. Let's give it up for Mr. Derrick Doerner, known as Bully. He is one of the best in the world at riding a wave with his body as his vehicle. North Shore lifeguard for nearly 30 years, ambassador of water, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Mark Cunningham. Professional surfing co-founder, Vans Triple Crown Executive Director for many years, and legendary North Shore shaper for the best of the best. Let's welcome Mr. Randy Rarick. One of the chargers in the eddy this year, it's been a treat to follow this surfer's ongoing escapades of chasing the big waves around the planet this El Nino year, Mr. Kohl Christensen. Reputation as a fearless charger of waves of epic proportions is well known and documented. On January 28, 1998, at Outside Log Cabins on the North Shore, he successfully towed into and rode an 80-foot wave. Winner of the Duke of Honomoku Invitational Surfing Championship in 1982. He is a big wave charger that is living the dream. It is our pleasure to present to you Mr. Ken Bradshaw. The Duke of Honomoku Invitational in 1967, he is one of Hawaii's most beloved wave riders. Recognized and respected by his elders, peers, and upcoming young guns, he is one of the North Shore's finest surfers of all time, a legendary tube rider, big wave surfer, and one of Hawaii's own, Mr. Jock Sutherland. One of our sport's most beloved surfers, he embodies the true essence of all things Hawaiian, which is love, aloha, and the art of storytelling. One of the best to charge heavy sunset in Waimea, he exemplifies the very essence of grace under pressure. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Mr. Kimo Hollinger. Honored guest defies introduction as he bears the name of one of the most respected families in surfing. Eddie went this year, and how glorious it was. And no one could deny that the most memorable moment was when this surfer, at 66 years of age, boldly rode that wave into the contest that bears the name of his brother, Eddie Aikau. It humbles my heart, fills me with pride to welcome to our hale this evening, Mr. Clyde Aikau. And so, gentlemen, I'm going to let you take it off from here, starting with Mr. Don Rohrer, to begin singing the praises of our special guest of the evening, Mr. Peter Kohl.
Well, first of all, Anna, thank you for the invite. Peter, congratulations to you and your family. God knows you deserve it. It's wonderful to be here. And I look around on this stage and guess who? I am the biggest lightweight that ever lived. Guys, we're all legends. Anyhow, Anna asked me here to talk a little bit about Peter's life-saving skills and some of the fun that we had on the beach. But first, you all know that he's a great surfer. You all know that he spent some time lifeguarding. But you may not know that Peter was also a famous football player at Santa Monica High School. His prowess was they had a terrific team. They won Bay League for years and years and years and years and years. Peter didn't start, but he was a quarterback, and he'd take the fastest kid on the team right after the warm-ups. The kid would run as fast as he could run, and Peter would throw the ball 60 or 70 yards, and the fans would go crazy. When Santa Monica got ahead in the game, the fans would stand up in the seats and go, put in Cole, because they wanted to see him throw that ball. Anyway, I had a chance to work with Peter and Buzzy both at Santa Monica Canyon in LA City. And we had some fun times. We made a lot of rescues on that beach. It was we'd get a south swell, push everybody up and get them into the rip at the Santa Monica Canyon storm drain, and we'd have to pull them all in and sometimes make 100 rescues a day. It was a very busy beach, but it was also a crazy beach. We had out-of-work actors, we had real actors, we had the big-time bodyguard. We had all these people, and the out-of-work actors would always try to do something that would one-up the other guy and be seen by one of the producers or whatever, I don't know. But Peter and I rowed. We raced dories, a 21-foot boat, weighed 300 pounds with two clowns stupid enough to get in there and race these things. Anyhow, at the end of our workouts, we'd have to take that dory and put it back in a locker. Well, one of the guys that would always be down there reading his scripts was Lee Marvin, and we would be tripping over Lee Marvin putting the damn dory away when we were through the workouts. The first dory race that Peter and I rode was at Santa Monica, and it was a mile race. And my oldest son was up on the pier with my wife, And Peter and I still laugh about this. Jeff was about, I don't know, 7 or 8 years old. And he's shouting down to Peter. He's going, "Peter, don't get nervous down there." So Peter and I rode that race. We got fourth. We got blocked. The team that blocked us never beat us again. But that was an interesting thing. We raced Huntington Beach in 10-foot surf. Got dumped. Beat everybody that didn't get dumped. We rode the Catalina race, which was 32 miles from Catalina to Manhattan Beach, and we had some success and a lot of fun. One of the races that Peter didn't make, though, was a race down in Redondo, and he was going to be in the Ironman, and Peter was the best Ironman on the coast in those days. So I get down there with a boat all ready to go, and Peter's not around. I look around, where the hell is Peter? He wasn't there. So I rode with another guy, and we did okay, and it comes time for the Ironman, Peter's still not there. And where is Peter? Well, it turns out Peter had been out late that night and thinking that he was going to be okay. He drove his car down to Redondo. He slept in the car and slept through the Dory race and slept through the Ironman. I worked in the tower one day and Peter comes out and he goes, "Hey, do you know how to take the sink apart?" I said, "Well, I guess so. Yeah, why?" He said, "I think I just flushed my contact lenses down there." He put his contact lenses in the thing to wash them and pulled the plug. And anyway, we took the sink apart and we never did find that. They were out in the ocean by the time we got there. Peter gets a call in the lifeguard tower. And he's going, "Really? Really? Are you sure? Oh, come on now. Are you sure?" And finally, he's through the conversation. He hangs up and I said, "What the hell was that?" He said, "That was Ricky Gregg. I just got a divorce." Ricky read out the paper over here and called Peter in the tower over there. Oh, it was a wonderful place to work. And we had Peter, and we had Buzzy Trent, and Dave Walton, the fellow who started Surfline Hawaii, on the beach guarding all at the same time. Think about that crew. Think about that crew. Anyway, it was my honor to work with you, Peter, and to know you as a friend. And thanks again for the invitation, and congratulations on your evening.
Me next. Tough act to follow, Doug. Somehow I became a lifeguard, and this guy is one of the fathers of contemporary modern lifeguarding, looking after Southern California and LA beaches for many, many, many years. So stoked to see Don here this evening. And here's the father of professional surfing sitting next to me over here. How about a big round of applause for Anna Trent Moore for bringing us all together? Thank you, Anna. What a wonderful evening. I want Sally Cole to stand up, the woman behind the man, because Sally, I don't know how you put up with the North Shore and all these knucklehead surfers for decades, and God bless you. Star of a Waikiki Aquacade back in the day, Sally could tell some stories herself. I can hardly wait for all the Sunset and my man guys to tell their story. I don't know why this pipeline guy is here. I'm stoked to see the Trim magazine there. I skimmed through it briefly, and there's that story. Is Matt Luttrell here, by the way, this evening? The editor, publisher of it? I don't see him. But anyway, interview with Anna Trent Moore, and the last story was interviews, talking story with Bud Browne and his favorite wave. Filming, playing, and body surfing was pipeline, so maybe that's how I earned my seat up here. I'd like to acknowledge Peter Shepherd Cole. Peter, stand up. This is Peter's son, and it's in here somewhere. He's got an art exhibit that's going to open tomorrow night at Ars Cafe, and it's a tribute out of Bud Browne stills. And I don't have my glasses on. 5 to 9 p.m.? 5 to 6 p.m.?
6 to 9.
6 to 9. I was close. Go. There's going to be plenty of food. It's on Montserrat Avenue's ARS Cafe. And
I'll pick you later.
Peter has done these incredible interpretations of Bud Browne film stills, and they're just gorgeous, huge canvases, tribute to his dad and Bud Browne the whole time there. That's all for me.
Usually Mark has a little more to say than that. Now, we got a lot of guys here, and we're going to move this along. Real briefly, I just want to thank Taylor and the crew here at the museum for this film festival, because it's so much work to put this together. And when I was 14 years old, Peter and John Weiser used to put on surf movies at the Waikiki Shell. And I was a little grom, and I used to put up posters back in the day. And then that evolved into, I actually produced about 150 films at Roosevelt High School, all but Bruce Ballard. So I really know what it is to put a surf film together at a surf film festival like this. So to Taylor, now let's give her a big hand. And in the film, when Peter was talking, he was saying, you know, there's Waimea, there's Makaha, and of course there's Pipeline. But Sunset is a place that's been dear to Peter's heart. And I actually live just down the street from Peter, right at Sunset. And I live two doors away from Ricky Gregg. So I started surfing Sunset at a really young age. And Ricky and Peter were my heroes. And I thought, if I can surf as long at Sunset as these guys can, then my life will be complete. And Peter really has been an inspiration. And it was really great surfing with Peter and Ricky and the guys. Until one day that Peter took off in a wave, and he was coming down the face at Sunset, and I was paddling out, and in his inimitable style, where you can see he doesn't be able to see anything. Right as he got to me, Peter turned, and I went, oh my God, I rolled over, and Peter ran into me and just about cut my leg off. And to this day, I can no longer knee paddle because of Peter. Thank you. But we're paying tribute to Peter, and well, so this is a tribute to Peter, but it's kind of like almost like sort of a retirement party to some extent. And most people, when they retire, they get a gold watch. But we figured Peter can't tell the time anyway. So I was trying to think, what can we come up with instead of a gold watch? And I came up with the perfect thing. And Peter, I know you're going to love this because it's your retirement party.
Oh, no.
We've got you a gold leash. Oh. And if anybody knows Peter, he's never worn a leash in his life, so now he's got one to wear. Congratulations, Peter.
Good one, Randy. Yeah, Peter is definitely one of our, not necessarily elders, but one of the people we looked up to. And Taylor was mentioning about not being hung up, as it were, in nostalgia, but just transcended. Nostalgia is okay, you know, looking back at what's been going on, but not to dwell on. But for me, growing up on the North Shore and having people like Peter and Jose Angel, Buzzy, Greg Noel, people like that, that came from California and are already very accomplished in surfing at that point for me, it was like mid-60s. Was great for me to be able to look up. I already was looking up to these guys, having seen them in films from Bud Browne and other people, and to be able to have them, you know, give me guidance out in the water and actually give me a compliment now and then, which I dearly love, was to me at the time was good. But now that I look at it later on in life, it was really, really gold. And then their influence, the California fellows combined with the people here in Hawaii, like Kimo and Georgie, Rustakaki, Wally Froissett, the combination of all of these gentlemen to me in my surfing endeavors, and to be able to pass it on to people like Dwayne DeSoto and his Nakamakai group, and to my two sons, as well as being still in half decent shape to be able to go out and surf, you know, with guys like Derrick, and occasionally if I'm lucky with Kimo and Randy and Mark and everybody else here on the stage, to me is really, really special. So thank you, Peter, for your part in that. I came along later in the picture, but still, yeah, we played, we had to swim. No matter how hard we tried to get Peter to wear a wetsuit, there was always the white t-shirt. No matter how far out we went out and we got caught inside, Peter would beat us to the beach. And there's not one person in this room that could swim faster than Peter Kohl. Amen to that. Peter was one that always taught us, all of us here, never turn your back on the sea and use your scene assessments and watch what the winds are doing and the sun and the birds and the current's always going to come before the swells. And all these little details and you just put all those things together, and it was like he was our surf machine, and he would always be down at our tower every day looking through that eyeball. And if there was a surf contest going on and it was really close to 4 o'clock, he was walking down to see Randy Rarick because he had to paddle out there for damn sure, because he hated contests. But more than people, at his later time in life, we blocked for him. He couldn't see a thing. I tell you what, if someone turned around and got in front of Peter Kohl, if it wasn't Randy or me or Kenny, we'd be screaming, "Hey!" Peter would get to his knee and get to his feet and ride this thing all the way through. He would paddle back out on his knees in his white t-shirt and his red shorts, on his knees, and we'd look at him and go, "That was a real hooter, wasn't it, Peter?" Thanks for all the things you've done for all of us and everyone here, and Sally and Kimo and Peter. Thanks for bringing me along.
I'm gonna tell you people the way of the world. When you're young and handsome, the girls don't like you because you know more money. When you finally get the money, the girls don't like you because you're old and ugly.
That's it. From your elders. I don't have to follow that. It was not like there was this wave building. It was just coming. It was my turn, and now it's breaking on my head. Well, I'm super humbled, obviously. I'm maybe the oldest? No. I mean, these guys paved the way for my generation, the generation, next generation. And I can't say enough, like, without them, we wouldn't be doing what we're doing, obviously. Not wearing a leash. I mean, what did Buzzy Trent say? He said, we may not be the best, but we're the toughest. I mean, you know what? He's right. Because what do we do? We wear leashes nowadays. We wear inflation vests. We're all these things. I mean, we may be better, but we're definitely not as tough. That's for sure. But yeah, I want to say it real quick. Thank you, Anna, for having us, and thank you, Sarah, because this month-long film festival, which is, this is like one of the coolest things out there. There's film festivals, but there's nothing that lasts this long in the world, and it's really special, and it's right here on our island. We really get to come enjoy it. But just being here, I just want to say thank you for even allowing me to sit up here with these legends, and I don't even what to say, because I got Cam Bradshaw and Clyde Aikau. Thank you.
Thank you, Cole. Trent Moore also, because she made all this possible for all of us to come and be a part of this and help pay tribute to one of our great inspirations in our lives. And believe it or not, Peter Kohl has that much power for all of us, I think, because he was that guy out there. He's the guy out there doing it every day, every time. And I always used to say that if I could, wherever you're going to, Peter, I'm going to go further. And that's what they're always telling. They say, you're my mile marker. So wherever you're going, I'm going that much longer and that much further. So I have to praise you for my inspiration, for me, and kept me going for so long, too. He was always out of Waimea. You had to make sure you had to stay out there, too. And my whole life, Peter's been a major influence on me. He lives right down the road. I see him all the time. We must talk probably every couple, three or four times a week, still. And it was such a pleasure having my life paralleling his life. I learned so much from him, and thank him so much. I would like to say thank you to Taylor for making this possible too. This was an amazing event. I'm glad I got to come. I'm glad I was invited. Thank you very much.
Yeah, don't mind me if I get a little emotional. I just kind of go that way. But anyway, I think it's really cool what Anna and the museum is doing this evening. Mostly to honor Peter. You know, at 66 years old, and a lot of the older guys up here, we've been through a lot of loss, you know, and it's a bummer, you know, because we really love our people and they pass on. But to be here this evening to really honor Peter, you know, while he's here and, you know, strong, and we can all express ourselves to Peter, really, really nice. Thank you, Anna, and thank you for the museum. I would like to recognize Lucky Cole, because, you know, my brother and I, Eddie, we surfed with Lucky, and he had a couple of big ones, and, you know, charging, and his wife here, too, lovely wife. But I want to back up what Mark said there. Sally has always been the bomb. I mean, no kidding, no lie. I mean, Eddie and me, when we first started surfing Sunset in the mid-60s, late-60s and the 70s, you know, Peter was our inspiration, along with Kimo. Eddie and I used to go down to the Shell and watch those surf movies by Bud Browne, and you know, on the screen was Peter charging, and Kimo was charging, and Greg Noe, and the inspiration really came from Peter, guys like Peter and Kimo and everybody else, you know, for Eddie to go out and ride those really big waves. But anyway, I just wanted to thank everybody for inviting us, and it's really an honor to be up here with all of these cool guys up here too, because you know there's a lot of a respect from me and my family to every single guy up here, you know, and you know, thank you for being so nice to my family and to my brother for all these years. And Peter, you know, when you talk ha'a ha'a, you know, you are talking humble. You know, and that is one word for me to Peter. He's always been a humble guy, you know. No matter where he was on the beach, the early years, the late years, no matter where we traveled all over the world, Peter was such a really cool guy. And thank you, Peter, for being such a nice guy to me, myself, my family, and aloha.
I can't help myself on one thing. It's short and sweet. There's the lifeguard connection, and I was honored to lifeguard with Derrick and Clyde and Eddie were lifeguards, and Bud was a lifeguard, and Peter was a lifeguard, and Kimo too. And I just, They have this wonderful saying, lifeguards for life, and it goes so Buffalo and Rel and Jimmy Bleers and just Bushman Art Sale, and it just goes on and on. I'm so honored to be a part of that. But one thing that I wanted, one last thing I wanted to say about Peter was thank you for taking care of the North Shore community. You were an early founder in Keep the Country Country, and you were certainly inspiration to me getting involved with Defend Oahu Coalition. And Peter, I believe you were the founder of Surf Rider Foundation Oahu chapter. Is that true? Yeah. And I just want to end on that note, folks, is that we've got to take care of our precious, beautiful island, and we've got to preserve our beautiful ocean. The ocean doesn't have a voice. It takes people like yourselves and Peter Cole to stand up and give the ocean a voice. So, Peter, thank you for taking care of our island home.
As I look up on stage and I see our faces here, and I see some representation from different times and different decades, it brings to mind, I was fortunate to be in Hawaii Nei in January, El Nino year. I wasn't fortunate to see the eddy. I did watch it on TV, but I was blessed to be able to come for El Nino year, and I was at Waimea when there was a big swell. I think there was a big swell every day this El Nino year. But one of the things I thought about when I was in Waimea was that our time on Earth is not infinite, and we all have only a certain amount of moments. And I really think surfing, we are so lucky to have that because it makes the moments grander. And I also thought, looking at the ocean, how the faces come and go, and that there's one thing that's constant, and that is why while we all inevitably pass at some time, the waves always come. They go and they come again. And how wonderful to dance, even for just a little while. And now, so you don't forget us, we have a little something for Mr. Peter Cole. And on behalf of the Bud Browne Film Archives, our love and our friendship to you, we'd like to present you this little commemorative, Sally can put flowers in it, to you tonight. So could you please come on down, Mr. Peter Cole. Give it up for Peter one more time. And we're going to...
What a wonderful meeting. I can't, I don't know what to say. This has been amazing. Somebody told me a month ago that this was going to happen. I wouldn't believe it. I have been getting a lot of people asking if I'm okay. Usually when you have a tribute like this, you're either dying, you're either dead or you're dying. But I'm still alive. What a great group. I just can't believe how wonderful the group is. Don't believe everything you hear. But it's really a good group. I mean, this is an admirable group of people. You can't believe how much fun we have surfing. At sunset, I call Sunset Beach the San Onofre of the North Shore. Because the average age in the lineup by sunset is always older than anywhere else on the North Shore. And but it's a group of camaraderie. We joke with each other. We give each other a bad time. And just one short anecdote. Kenny loves to get a lot of waves. And I don't get any waves. You know? He gets more waves in one session than I get for the whole year. But he always comes up and tells me this is my 30th wave, this is my 40th wave, and I haven't got any waves yet. But the crowning blow was he had gotten his shoulder screwed up and he was out body surfing. And he had to tell me all the waves he got body surfing. So this is a real good group. I mean, Don Rohrer and I at State Beach working with Bob Burns and Buzzy Trent, I mean, you couldn't believe that how I used to look forward to my work at lifeguarding. The day would go so fast. We had all these Hollywood B actors and actresses, and some of them are pretty good looking, the girls. And we hardly could watch the beach, but Buzzy and Bob Burns, was the head guard, they loved to make rescues. Well, in those days, we had rules that you wouldn't allow anybody with an inner tube or a life raft to go out in the ocean. And it was totally wrong. And the first day I lifeguard there, Buzzy and Bob Burns were there, I'm lifeguarding with them. And I see a guy with a tube, and I go down there to take the tube out, and Bob Burns and Buzzy are both, Buzzy saying, you don't take any, you got in trouble with those tubes. And I'm saying, what do you mean? He said, well, we need rescues. I could go on forever on Buzzy Trent's stories. I mean, Buzzy was a classic. I mean, people that know Buzzy will never forget him. He was just unbelievable. And I could go on and tell you all night about him. You probably want to see the movie, but first of all, I'd like to say that Anna does a really good job with this last night of the Surf Festival. And I just want to say, I love knowing Buzzy and seeing Buzzy's daughter being such a great woman and so much like Buzzy. I mean, it's just amazing. You couldn't have a person with more charisma than Ron is terrific. And their son, Cody. And then Anna's brother, Ivan. I mean, Ivan is so much like Buzzy. I was surfing YMA. This was towards the tail end of my surfing. I think it was in the 90s, mid-90s. I'm surfing with, and I see Ivan get this double wave pull down, just a horrendous hold down, and he comes out booty, you know, because like it was fun, you know. Now, we're going to have a film, you're going to see Surfing the 50s, and I just want to give a little background on that. Bud Browne, John Weiser and I decided that we used to watch Bud. It used to suffer watching Bud at these surf films that he put on. He's a real shy guy. He's not an extrovert, and he's about as much an introvert as you get. And he's very shy, and he's very quiet, and he's very unassuming, and he's a great guy. But he'd have these shows, and he'd be up there, and he'd have the music on a tape recorder. He'd have the projector back there that he'd line up. He'd get up on the stage. The projector would get screwed up. He'd get off the stage. He'd have to go back. One time, the film got loose on the projector, and it was rolling down the aisle. And all of this in the middle of the greatest group of Grammy jerks in the world. They'd throw Mickey Dora and those guys would throw firecrackers during the show. And Bud would put up a lot. So John Weiser and I decided, we got to help Bud. So in 1961, we decided we'd help Bud. And I kind of talked John Weiser. And John Weiser had worked at K-Poy at the time. And then he started this radio station named Kumu, and it was a rock and roll thing. And Weiser was a real character. He was a swimmer at Stanford a couple of years behind me, and we decided to help Bud. So we would do the soundtrack, and we'd help Bud, and we'd do the comedy sequences. So we the first film we got involved with Bud was called Spinning Boards, and we thought, gee, these surf films are so kind of the same thing. It shows these Grammys getting in trouble, and they're doing this and that. We thought that humor and all that stuff is old. We gotta have something new. So we decided what would really be good is to have commercials in the middle of the movie. So Weiser and I decided to create all these commercials, black and white commercials. And we showed it at the Santa Monica Auditorium. That was our first show. And Mickey Doroth said it was the best surf film he ever saw. He went to it about three times. We saw him all the time going to these, because it was really kind of out to lunch type humor that he loved. But we would have these commercials in the middle of a break, like we'd have a guy getting a real big wave and we'd stop and say, just a minute, we'll have to come back with this time. And the first commercial, and Bud Browne, we had this black screen, and Bud Browne would get up there and say, I was going to bring you this, but I ran out of money. And he said, so we were going to have to do it, and he had this real small screen and black and white. He says, I wasn't going to do this, but then because of my sponsors, I'm able to bring you Loom, and we have this color. But the first commercial was Ricky Gregg always had pretty girls around, and Ricky had this girlfriend, an ex-girlfriend, that was real pretty, and we thought, well, the first commercial will be a Lady Moonbeam shaving. And we got this girl, and John Weiser was really funny. He'd go through this long kind of radio type advertising and everything, and they said the Lady Moon and all this stuff, and then all of a sudden she went to shave her legs. Well, it wasn't her leg, it was my leg. Started the whole thing, and it got a lot of but we had a few that were kind of risky, you know, sort of. But mothers would come up and say, "Oh, that's horrible! You show that stuff to my kid, you know." And Bud Browne is very conservative. And the next thing you know, that black commercial was out. And then this next commercial was out. By the end of the summer, there were only three commercials out of 20 left. But it was fun. And Bud Browne surfing the 50s. In 1993, he decided to gather us all together and have he called John Kelly and myself. We'd come over there, Bud paid our transportation, we flew over there to meet him in Costa Mesa, and then we would help him with this editing and creating this surf film and doing the narration. So, I got together with Bud, and Bud is now 81, and I think I was 63 at the time, and John Kelly was maybe, 77 or something. He's a little younger than Bud, and we're all these old guys, and we're all getting back together, and we're all doing this stuff that we had done 30 years earlier. And, you know, with all this high-tech stuff, Bud Browne had not changed at all. He still had the scissors. He still had the masking tape in the cardboard box, and he would clip out a little film and stick it in. And I still went in and said, "Bud, look at that. That's a good ride of mine. Look at that sunset." Flip into the bar. So we had a wonderful time. We went over there for 2 weeks. But John Kelly was real big on this. The missionaries and what they did to Hawaii and how they ruined Hawaii, and he went on and on and on, and he was driving Bud nuts, because Bud has paid our way over, and he had a short time to do this film, and all John Kelly could do was talk about the missionaries and all this stuff, you know. And finally, Bud was, his nose was getting real red and swelling. Because Bud never gives anybody a bad time, but his nose was, if I had a needle, it would have popped. And So I told John, I said, John, you're going to drive Bud nuts. I said, we got to get to work. I said, I'll tell you what, if you just stop all this stuff, we'll give you a little bit of time in the movie where you can spot out all that stuff. So when you see the movie at the end, you'll get John Kelly's missionary thing. But John Kelly is a class act. And I have to say, the guys that aren't with us anymore were real class acts. And I miss all of them. I miss Kit Horn, I miss Buzzy, I miss John Kelly. We just missed Wally Frohside, we missed Rabbit. I mean, it's just endless the number of people that were with us. Ricky Gregg, Buzzy Trent, and all those guys were class people, and I'm sorry that they're not here to enjoy this, and to they'd give me a really bad time for this. But it's a good movie, and we had a lot of fun making it, and at the end of the thing, we all went down to the wedge and body surfed, and we had a ball, I'm telling you. It was about 6 foot, and the waves would come into the rocks there. It's the best body surf, I think, there is. And you could get these waves, and go parallel to the beach and go under where everybody's taking these drops. You could go under them and go down the beach, and we were hooting and hollering and having a great time. So I want to say, when you watch the Surfing the 50s, realize that it's a bunch of old guys back in the 93 that were redoing what they did years before. But I think you'll enjoy it. It's a fun movie. And thanks, everybody, for being here. And I have to say, I've never had more fun in my life than surfing with a bunch of characters like these.
This concluded the tribute to Peter Cole, and then they showed the movie Surfing in the 50s, and that was the end of the evening. Thank you.